Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Uncertain, The Wisdom and Wonder of Being Unsure, by Maggie Jackson. Narrated by Maggie Jackson. For Anna, Emma, and John, with all my heart and soul. I know seems to describe a state of affairs which guarantees what is known, guarantees it as a fact. One always forgets the expression, I thought I knew. Ludwig Wittgenstein. Introduction. On the night before he gave one of the most transcendent speeches of our time, Martin Luther King Jr. did not quite know what he would say. In the weeks leading up to the 1963 March on Washington, he had sought extra counsel from advisors and had closely studied their suggested drafts. On the eve of the event, his aides gathered at his invitation in a hotel lobby to press their ideas upon him. Everyone had a stake in this speech, a predetermined angle, recalled an advisor on the address they sensed would voice their cause to the world. That spring, news footage of police unleashing fire hoses and attack dogs on protesters had captured the world's attention and energized the faltering civil rights movement. Now, its leaders were deeply divided over whether force should be met with force. Segregation was under siege, yet the way forward was far from clear. It was a hinge moment for the crusade and in the country's history. King reworked his speech long into the night and even from the dais. Then, 10 minutes into its telling, he put it aside altogether and set out on his own. In the first few minutes of his remarks, King had accused the country of defaulting on the promissory note of equality owed to all by the Constitution. Offering a glimpse of his growing radicalism, he had vowed whirlwinds of revolt against prejudice and poverty. In closing, it would have been easy then to tick off the movement's wins or to set forth specific demands, historians note. Instead, he offered a distant vision of a better time, a dream that critics then and now have called nebulous, ethereal, and undefined. King rose to lead the movement with conviction and humility, often admitting to allies and skeptics alike that he did not know the way. Social revolutions, he once said, are not all neat and tidy. Nor was he the type of activist who pursued a merely finite agenda, notes author Gary Young. That August afternoon, he asked 250,000 marchers and the world at large to work toward magnificent possibilities, equality, fellowship, freedom. But he shunned as weapon or reward the brittle ease of pat answers. Go back home, knowing somehow this situation can and will be changed, King told the protesters. Somehow. That day, for a moment, wrote James Baldwin, it almost seemed that we stood on a height and could see our inheritance. Perhaps we could make the kingdom real. Perhaps. In the crowd, someone held a placard high for all to see. We demand freedom of mind. We cannot find the best path forward, King was saying, by assuming that we already know the way. The revolution that he urged was left undone at his death. His legacy remains contested, yet his words continue to provoke and inspire to a degree few could have foreseen. Not knowing whether building a new order was a Sisyphean task or merely a Herculean one, he called out in the political wilderness, creating a vision on which our modern rights are built, notes Young. That day, argues historian Drew Hansen, he began the long overdue process of changing America's idea of itself. King responded to the vehement yeses and noes of the moment with the courage of a maybe, the only call to action that fully confronts the unknown. In both his soaring exhortation and its precarious creation lies a truth too urgent to ignore. The best of thinking begins and ends with the wisdom of being unsure. uncertainty is strength? Indecision fueling greatness? King's feat is admittedly glorious, yet its hidden dimensions are confounding too. After all, being unsure is not what our species wants to be. The wrong turn that leaves you in a strange neighborhood after dark, the days spent awaiting a medical test result and the sticky choices that may follow, such experiences rattle us, and naturally so. Humans are built for survival's sake, to yearn for answers, and for the predictability that offers them up. Situations that we can breeze through with just the right effort, what psychologists call a state of fluency, literally bring a smile to our faces. They are plain wonderful, all dopamine and reward. We don't want to think hard about how to exit the shadowy forest and get home. In contrast, the state that the poet Keats called half-knowledge will always be a hard sell. It's a proven psychological finding. People tend to be more stressed if they don't know if an electric shock is coming than if they're pretty sure they will get one. Now, uncertainty as a path to progress is all the harder to imagine, a seemingly antiquated way forward at best. There were deep divisions in 1963, blood on the streets, an escalating war on the horizon. But today, the furious pile-on of unknowns fueled by pandemics, disasters, tottering democracies, economic fragility, and social unrest drive laments about these uncertain times to fever pitch. Choosing to linger in the middle ground of the indefinite appears starkly counter to moving forward. It's dinner party dynamite just to admit that on a matter of social import, your opinion isn't set in stone. How could we find the clarity and vision so urgently needed by not knowing? This book is about the unsung triumph of doing just that. Early one morning during the fearful spring when the first wave of coronavirus struck New York, I was returning home after a walk in the park. Approaching my apartment building, I saw a neighbor a bit ahead who was about to go inside. He spotted me over his shoulder, and I could sense what he was thinking. Holding the door open for me, as we typically would do, would shatter the distance that should be kept between us. On the other hand, hurrying in first and leaving me behind would assail a moment's solidarity just when we needed it most. I knew him only by sight. He was a city guy perpetually in a rush. Yet, to my surprise, there he stood, musing and torn. And then, without a word, he gave the door a mighty push open, enough for him to enter and for me to follow safely in the next lingering beat. That day, when so much was in question, he found a way to protect us and our humanity, if only for a minute or two. It was the smallest of victories, born of a remarkable feat, an uncertain mind. This book tells the story of a kind of brilliance too often squandered, a state of mind critical to human achievement, yet until recently little understood. Far from automatically miring us in cognitive paralysis, uncertainty plays an essential role in a higher order thinking, propelling people in challenging times toward good judgment, flexibility, mutual understanding, and heights of creativity. It is the portal to finding your enemy's humanity, the overlooked linchpin of superior teamwork, and the mindset most needed in times of flux. Rather than being a sign of deficiency or weakness, wielding the cognitive tool of not knowing is a mark of the persuasive arguer, the most capable student, the resilient physician and patient, and by multiple measures, the nimble executive. It can even make people more romantically inviting. In the game of love, we see those who aren't sure about us as more attractive. So far as man stands for anything and is productive and originative at all, his entire vital function may be said to have to deal with maybes, wrote William James. Not a victory is gained, not a deed of faithfulness or courage is done, except upon a maybe. Yet we now treat this gateway to life's richest cognitive possibilities as a secret shame. Amidst fury, confrontation, angst, and flux, strident calls are rising for an urgent rethink of what came before. This is the moment, it is said, when we can right past wrongs and dig out from the cataclysms before us. All kinds of narratives and shibboleths are beginning to quake, asserts historian Carol Anderson.
But these fledgling hopes and stirrings of change ultimately may prove fragile, even stillborn, unless all sides first work to re-envision a culture that has transformed an innate human love of quick, sure answers into a foundational value of the time.
In an era of the algorithm and the checklist, preferred information sweeps away context and contradiction with what economists Mervyn King and John Kay call spurious precision. In an age of ghosted lovers, online mobs, and spreading autocracy, the kind of human judgment that demands a bit of time and a second thought begins to look quaint, warns Helga Nowotny, a leading sociologist of science. Conviction remains essential. At times, the heroic impulse will land true. But too often, our understanding is timid and shrunken beneath rising bravado and noise. It is not uncertainty that we should fear, but a growing reluctance and perhaps a waning ability to seek nuance, depth, and perspective, all fruits of skillfully confronting what we do not know. This path does not offer the easy way out. Uncertainty unsettles us, and that is its gift. But what do we mean when the talk turns to uncertainty? How could such a ubiquitous aspect of life be so misunderstood? Although economists, psychologists, and risk analysts still debate the contours and boundaries of this concept, they categorize uncertainty largely into two main types, one involving life's unpredictability and another our own psychological unsureness. And most of the time, whether in scholarly circles, the day's headlines, or talk around the kitchen table, uncertainty is treated foremost as something out there, a kind of unwelcome intrusion into life. This is aleatory uncertainty, or what we call the uncertainty, that is, the randomness of the universe. It's what we cannot know. From there, the conversation quickly takes the probabilistic turn. What are the odds that the markets turn bullish by spring? How likely is it that the virus will mutate again? For centuries, a complex set of statistical tools, the fuel behind the data models now in vogue, has dominated modern efforts to confront what the world throws at us. Until recently, the taming of chance seemed literally our best bet for trading up from ancient sacrifices to the fates to making a calculated dent in the unknown. Now, however, the science of uncertainty is expanding to encompass not just mathematical fates, but also the wider, wilder territories of our uncertainty, the main topic of this book. Epistemic uncertainty is the starting point of all pursuit of knowledge. Scientists increasingly agree. Even probability theories pay rising homage to people's subjectivity, i.e., how often idiosyncratic estimates sway the tallying of likelihood. By definition, this state of mind essentially entails recognizing that you do not know in full. Your understanding is fuzzy, contradictory, or partial. This sense of incompleteness is not the blank slate associated with full ignorance. Instead, it means you have realized the limits of your knowledge and gained a glimpse of worlds beyond your own assumptions or views. Your child has the sniffles, and you begin to suspect that it may not be just a cold or allergies. Perhaps your design prototype lacks something that neither focus groups nor your team can yet articulate. What then? It might be, it could be, it's possibly this or that or another option altogether. In not knowing, there's a golden promise of further possibilities and a sense of falling short. Enter the innate drive for answers that pioneering psychologist Jerome Kagan famously called one of the foremost determinants of human behavior. The resolve to conclusively know keeps us moving forward, yet it is very much double-edged, both a strength and a weakness. In essence, we are constantly working to reduce the very cognitive capacity that most broadens our mental horizons. Here is the dilemma posed each time we confront what's beyond our ken and why uncertainty's gifts are often elusive.
Faced with a glimpse of a challenge or a question, do we rush to seize an answer or do we slow down to wonder, to consider, and to explore?
Thought hastens toward the settled and is only too likely to force the pace, observed the philosopher John Dewey.
Remarkably, even the psychology field long viewed uncertainty as simply something for humans to eradicate as fast as possible, and so largely overlooked this mindset as a topic of study in itself.
But no longer are researchers dismissing uncertainty as a cognitive wasteland. Consider the executives who not long ago faced the European Union's most dramatic expansion, an embrace of Central Europe that nearly doubled the group's membership. Widely seen as enacted hastily and with little concern for its economic impact, the 2004 event was the antithesis of Brexit, but nearly as controversial. Which chief executives would best adapt? Those who viewed the shift as a boon, or those who assumed that the vast new competitive market would hurt their company's prospects? Pro or con? In or out? The business world, in both theory and practice, often has tended to hold that in a crisis, effective leaders come down on one clear side or another. So which would it be? Two top management professors launched a study of 104 chief executives in Germany to find out. It didn't go quite as planned. After completing an intensive first round of interviews and surveys at the time of the merger, the researchers discovered to their surprise a third group in the mix. A quarter of the executives were torn by competing possibilities. Would the shifting trade landscape offer a burgeoning customer base, an uptick in inflation, or pressure from new rivals to lower labor costs? These leaders were unsure, and they unexpectedly turned out to be the ones worth emulating. When the researchers returned a year later to see how the entire group had fared, they found that the intense ambivalence popularly equated with inertia had had the opposite effect. We actually ran the analysis many times in different ways to make sure we weren't chasing some fluke, Klaus Weber of Northwestern University, co-author of the study published in 2009, told me. It was no fluke. Those who sustained a meld of positive and negative views on the crisis, who in effect saw their understanding as incomplete, considered a wider range of responses, included more diverse voices in decision-making, and responded with more novel and resourceful measures, such as building a plant in a new member territory. Their ambivalence inspired a more subtle understanding of the problem and actions better calibrated to the situation. There's a reality out there that is not binary, says Weber. In contrast, the executives who are most sure of the way forward, or who assumed they were fully in control, tended to take the path of least resistance. They stuck to the tried and true, and sometimes did nothing at all. This is not a saga of humility trumping hubris, although we can hear hints of such virtue in the tale. Instead, the study and a growing body of corresponding research across disciplines offers something more, an upending of our outdated ideas of what a wise thinker can be. When the stakes are high, those who do not know gain the cognitive advantage. To understand how uncertainty can propel us forward, let us first consider the Mount Olympus of the mind, the slow-to-mature skullcap of cortical tissue draped over older regions of the brain. At the fore of the neocortex lie the frontal lobes, whose workings first came to light in studies of World War I soldiers with head injuries who could no longer master new tasks or grasp the big picture of their lives. This region is home ground of the executive you, the artful discerner that Plato compared to a charioteer steering the steeds of unruly appetite and higher instinct in pursuit of heavenly ideals. The scientific reality is less romantic, but the metaphor remains apt. The new mind is highly linked to brain systems dealing with cognitive control. And the side of ourselves that holds the reins is the one that can slow to examine the inconsistencies that our innate reactivity dashes past. Day to day, humans spend much of their time jumping to conclusions based on cognitive shortcuts honed from what's worked in the past. To an experienced doctor, for example, a patient's chest pains instantly signal a possible heart attack. By ignoring ambiguity, intuitive thinking offers pop-up answers that serve us well in the predictable environments that scientists call benign. Smooth and neat, what we sense from our gut typically carries a comforting feeling of knowing. Observes the psychologist and Nobel laureate Daniel Kahneman, a remarkable aspect of your mental life is that you are rarely stumped. But when something goes amiss, the familiar trade block blows open, the algorithm wreaks havoc, we gain an astonishing chance to break from autopilot, pivot, and reassess. We have the opportunity to engage in the conflict processing needed to cope with error, competing choices, contradictions, and broken expectations. In essence, humans have evolved a counterweight to the drive-by reactivity that makes quick work of a situation by sticking to script. This is when you can relinquish the safe ground of routine, take a close, fresh look at what rings false or true, and grapple with new possibilities. Ever-ready gut cognition is slow to learn and resistant to change. Its speed belies its stodginess. The best of thinkers, in contrast, are willing to question, and so are agile. They do not, as Aristotle once warned, measure a fluted column with a straight edge. And this wisdom can begin only with the realization that the world is imperfect, and so are you. When trouble strikes, a mismatch emerges between old expectation and new reality, between routine and change. Recognizing this gap, we are caught short, and what follows is the key to human adaptability. For at that moment, a frisson of not knowing ignites a sense of unusualness that spawns greater engagement with an issue and a widening of attentional focus. You become highly alert to what's new and better able to learn. Working memory, the capacity to hold an idea in mind and work with it, expands when we are unsure, studies suggest. The brain is directing energy to itself. This is why leading researchers consider uncertainty a good form of stress. Our uncertainty is both a signal of possible danger and the state of mind that invokes the considered thinking needed to update a now deficient understanding of the world. The deadline nears, an answer is demanded. This is just the time that, corner office or no, we yearn simply to act, not to decide when, how, or why. But superior thinkers do not assume that all is easily in hand. They face their ignorance and wake up to its implications, leveraging trouble into agility through the power of their uncertainty. To see these skills in action, look no further than the famously skeptical Kahneman. His relentless questioning of long-accepted views of the mind inspired his and Amos Tversky's pioneering work, Revealing the Limits of Shortcut Thought. Kahneman's defining characteristic is doubt, says a former student, and it's very useful, because it makes him go deeper and deeper and deeper. Uncertainty is a gadfly of the mind, jolting us from complacency if we're willing to answer its call. I'm going to show you some pictures. Tell me whether each is more like a dog or a cat. With these brief instructions, a pioneering University of California, Berkeley psychologist began giving people so-called tests of perception that were in fact extraordinary barometers of their capacity to relish the twists and turns of life. Participants were shown a series of drawings of an animal that at first distinctly resembled a cat, but then, bit by bit, with a tweak to an ear or a broadening of a muzzle, turned fully canine. The middle pictures were indeterminate, and for some, that proved unnerving. Again and again, these participants refused to surrender the safe harbor of their first answer until the sequence was nearly complete. They showed a preference to escape into whatever seems definite, wrote the researcher Elsa Frankel Brunswick. The famous cat-dog experiments were part of a post-war search by some of the world's leading scientists for the roots of authoritarianism and prejudice. What Frankel Brunswick discovered for her part was a key signature of the closed mind, intolerance of uncertainty. Reaping the promise of not knowing depends on a simple rubric, whether people are intent on eradicating uncertainty or are willing to stay open to it and so to a situation's subtleties and complexities. This is a decision made in the moment, yet one that also emerges from an individual's personal comfort zone for uncertainty. Being uncertain means that I lack confidence. There really is no such thing as a problem that can't be solved. I should be able to organize everything in advance. These are statements drawn from the intolerance of uncertainty and tolerance for ambiguity tests, classic assessments that have been attracting new attention as tools for unlocking the upsides of not knowing. Ambiguity, the state of being inexact or open to multiple interpretations, is a source of uncertainty. In essence, the tests measure the degree to which people view being unsure as a challenge or as a threat, a distinction that affects how well we learn, argue, explore, invent, and solve problems. Those who shun the indefinite tend to see the world in shades of black and white, ignoring the gray. They are prone to jump to answers and are distressed by chaos and surprise. Their cognitive map is narrowed to rigidly defined tracks, wrote Frankel Brunswick. In contrast, people who operate on the other side of the scale are more likely to be curious, flexible thinkers who revel in complex problems and in new experiences, from living abroad to trying a new delicacy. They may even be in better charge of their minds. Evidence suggests that such thinkers have more gray matter, i.e. neural volume, in brain regions related to executive control. In the study of the mind, a tolerance is a tendency, not a fate. We are all more or less prone to be introverted or outgoing, impulsive or reflective, and to welcome the opportunity of incertitude or not. A refusal to not know isn't a guaranteed mark of fascism or bigotry any more than someone who dislikes parties is automatically a full-on recluse. And while political conservatives are a little more reluctant to embrace uncertainty, the well-publicized link between these two complex concepts is weak. Many liberals detest surprises, and no small number of conservatives revel in change. We all have a personal appetite for not knowing, but the real news is that this leaning is malleable. Situation and context matter. Under time pressure, almost everyone's eagerness to race to a conclusion deepens. At the same time, through practice and a bit of effort, we can bolster our capacity for lingering in the gray spaces where cognitive treasures abound. It is possible to move the dial. Picture a laboratory experiment that brought together pairs of strangers with opposing political views for a brief online back and forth on a controversial topic such as abortion or gun control. The interactions that unfolded in the 2016 study were just the kind that so often go quickly awry. This is the moment when the cognitive mismatch that confronts us isn't a mystery virus or a trade policy shift, but another person with a wholly different view, an opponent, we say. The potential for conflict processing awaits. At the outset, half of the pairs were coached to take on a highly competitive point-scoring mindset. The other duos were told to cooperatively learn as much as they could from one another. In 15 minutes, this slight difference in stance shifted the participants' approach to the world. The pairs of strangers who were gunning to outperform one another turned more absolutist, that is, lovers of sureness in learning and knowledge. They became more likely to believe that there was one unerring truth to the matter and that they held it like a rock that they could seize and defend. In contrast, those who had been primed to learn became more evaluative. They began to see knowing as inherently uncertain and as something best forged from multiple viewpoints. "I can absolutely see that point," said one participant. They were no less confident in their views. Contrary to what we might expect, having the courage to tolerate ambiguity is associated with assertiveness. But by being open to new, challenging information, they grew willing to examine and modify their position. They treated their understanding as akin to an evolving yet durable tapestry, its strength deriving from its very suppleness and mutability. From such a vantage point, more skillful and persuasive arguments are made. No one seminar or script can transform us into virtuosos of not knowing. We don't have a home run magic bullet for this, a leading scientist of uncertainty chided when I pressed him for an antidote to our fear of the unknown. We can't inject all this, bottle it, and put it into some easy intervention, said Paul K.J. Hahn, a senior physician scientist at the National Institutes of Health. One-shot fixes are the pipe dreams of an instant answer age, he was reminding me. Still, neither should we ignore the myriad chances that await us each day to open our minds to uncertainty and to its remarkable potential. If both arguers refuse to adjust their beliefs, no progress can take place, wrote the lead researchers of the 2016 study. I have read the contrasting transcripts from experiments of this kind, the raw, curt battles on one hand, and the gentle, winding interactions on the other. But perhaps most telling are the awkward silences within each debate. When a lull arises, as they inevitably do, seekers of certainty tend to try to close down the argument in their favor, sometimes with taunts. Those who are endeavoring to learn from the back and forth instead often admit at that juncture that they're not completely sure about their position. For them, a trifling break in an exchange becomes a chance to expand their thinking with an opponent's helping hand. Such thinkers do not merely tolerate the realm of the indefinite, they are seeking its potential. For within that bewildering zone lies transformation itself. Finding agility in the Sturm und Drang, the storm and stress of what's unsure, may always be daunting. Studies from linguistics to philosophy confirm what we suspect, and brain science reveals. Uncertainty is not for the faint of heart. According to psychologist Michael Smithson, the metaphors typically used to portray this state include darkness, lostness, and fuzziness, as well as realms that can beckon, such as wandering, exploration, and wilderness. Being unsure is forever linked to feeling on the edge, not quite in control. Yet, a spate of not knowing is not time wasted. Let go of the notion that answers are always at hand, wade into the wilderness of uncertainty, and new perspectives open to view. When we seek to deny uncertainty, life becomes a realm of cramped and ultimately brittle experience, writes the historian of science, Jerome Ravitz. Was it a menacing smirk or an inscrutable smile? Were they the bullies or the harassed? From what little that could be seen on the film clip, the encounter on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial was strange and fraught. A throng of teen boys in blaze red hats chanting school songs stood face to face with a native man from the Omaha Nation drumming his spirituals. A video cropped to shock had its intended effects. A virtual pylon spiraled into death threats against the youths and their families. A viral campaign to fire their principal erupted even as he threatened to expel them from school. Deplorable, shameful, the Greek choruses of the time rose up to have their say. Within hours, lawmakers, pundits, a bishop, and scores of the video's 2.5 million viewers had treated a mystery as a certainty. A mere quarter of online posts are opened before they're shared, retweeted, or liked, studies show. Are we becoming like search engines, dispatching answers before questions are fully asked? Soon the lens of public attention began to zoom out. There were holes in the drummer's story, and a realization that provocateurs had been part of the wider crowd. There were opportunities to see the ambiguities, to pause and look again. Instead, calls for restraint were lost in a cacophony of deepening conviction. A columnist who urged uncertainty as an antidote to rising cycles of outrage was mocked by hundreds online. When Martin Luther King stood on those steps half a century earlier, he spoke of the fierce urgency of now. Wrongs must be undone, he argued. Yet he stressed that this work must be tempered by dignity and discipline, by a humility in knowing.
He extolled a fevered crowd to strive, to dream, and not to assume that being sure means being right.
We have forgotten his plea. Rights and wrongs there will be. Judgments must be made. But what deepens our plight is a rising faith in the finality of knowing. Ignoring a telling nuance or another view seems no longer the byproduct merely of bustling efficiency, but a goal we deliberately seek. And in this shift from neglecting chances to not know to asserting, I don't ever want to know, lies a world of difference and risk. A fifth of Democrats and an equal proportion of Republicans, tens of millions of adults, view many members of opposing political parties as not fully human. Public figures and friends alike who are deemed objectionable are canceled, i.e. boycotted, especially online. Inconsistencies and contradictions and the people who represent them are not merely seen as unworthy of investigation, they have no right to exist. But we should not forget, especially amidst rising violence and calamity, that answers both right and wrong must have afterlives. The best understanding is subject to continual change and discovery, or else its foundations crumble, leaving us clinging to paper-thin stances. Unless we take up the provocation of uncertainty, we miss out on life's surprises, along with the chances to recognize change and opportunities to be changed, and not least, the unassuming grace of slowing down to think. Humans share with animals a half dozen core instincts to flee, fight, coordinate, feed, reproduce, and freeze to gather more information. Over millennia, these moments of instinctual slowing evolved into the human capacity to direct our fate by consciously working through the unknown. Unearthing an unseen connection, exploring the mystery of an opposing view, or simply realizing when a conversation has gone adrift demands what psychologist Jerome Bruner calls a detachment of commitment.
Whether it is thrust on us or is strategically sought, this discomforting moment is not a cessation of all doing, but rather a shift in tempo and cognitive gears, signaling that we have begun mining the promise of the unknown.
A pause is not a time when nothing happens, says Stanford University neuroscientist Vinod Menon. In a pioneering experiment, Menon and his research team eavesdropped on the thought patterns of 18 people as they listened to Baroque symphonies. To the scientists' astonishment, the participants' brains were most active during the morsels of silence between movements. A pause in the music brought listeners to a cognitive cliff edge. By violating their expectations of continuity, the seeming nothingness of the moment became a space of further possibility in thought. The tiny study made the cover of the prestigious scientific journal Neuron and headlines around the world. Long ago, the Roman statesman Cicero used the word incertus, meaning not evident or undiscerned, as a term for uncertainty in a treatise that was part of his efforts to popularize Greek philosophy in ancient Rome. He could have been talking about the gifts of uncertainty themselves. Until a century ago, nature was assumed to be largely a realm of divine regularity, and the heavens were seen as fixed and orderly. Until a decade or two ago, The brain was thought to be modular and set in place by the time we reached adulthood. After that, intelligence and temperament were assumed to be unchanging. Until recently, humans were hailed as creatures of rationality and as predictable as the stars in the sky. The rise of early modern science and technology fueled the belief that humanity could uncover the inner mechanisms of a clockwork world and so bend nature to its will. By and large, the best thinkers were seen as detached observers, masters of logic and mathematics, and above all, as Descartes taught, slayers of the dragon of doubt. Decision trees and moral algebra, checklists and obedience to the algorithmic, these are legacies of what the philosopher John Dewey called the quest for certainty, a view of the world inside and outside our heads that increasingly is being called into question as the last word in thinking. Humans are prone to race to answers, to cling to what they know, yet they're also far more cognitively capable than the ideals of classical rationality allowed. The Enlightenment, as great as its achievements were, held up a straight edge to the mysteries of the mind. Now, we are told, the cosmos is expanding. At the smallest quantum level, space and time are indefinite, ever-shifting realms whose dynamism epitomizes life's deep impermanence. One after another, the laws of nature are being unmasked as provisional, while our understanding, as Einstein, Picasso, and Morrison taught, is relative to what we see and where we stand. Almost wherever one turns, the accepted version is under siege, from the grand schema of the heavens to what it means to know. Uncertainty rattles the chains of our assurance, like it or not. The broken promises of the digital age taunt us. Only a scant percentage of Americans believe that technology has boosted our curiosity, knowledge, or understanding. Trust in many major institutions and in one another has been pummeled in recent years.
Social media and water cooler chat alike pulse with burgeoning anxiety, a state that psychologists now define as a fear of the unknown.
Historian Daniel Boorstin calls it the age of negative discovery, a realm no longer of answers, but only of questions. Is a retreat into certainties, old and new, our best recourse? Or can we rise above days increasingly marked by clashing denials, inflexible technologies, and expectations that knowledge is effortless and more closely tailored to what we already like and comprehend? It's time now to shine a spotlight on a new kind of heroism, the capacity to harness the powers of uncertainty that snap judgment and classical rationality alike seek to dispel. The product of hundreds of interviews and thousands of miles of travel, this book shows us how to skillfully confront the unknown and how to seek not knowing in the service of wisdom, wonder, and discovery. When we stop running from uncertainty, we can tame the fear of not knowing that keeps us at a toxic remove from a multifaceted, evolving understanding of reality, and that stunts our capacity for soaring flights of imagination. We can begin to explore the contours of all that we do not understand, and so adapt to what's muddy or new, from the demands of an unfolding disaster to the evidence that punctures a beloved conviction. By questioning ideals of success and thought as pat and quick, we can recognize how rarely does one tempo, a single viewpoint, or a neat template suffice. Most of all, we can discover uncertainty both as a remarkable cognitive tool, in effect a skill for good thinking, and as a critical time and space that sets us on the fertile edge of what we do not know. Each chapter examines a different mode of what I call uncertainty in action, from the honed unsureness that world-class experts wield mid-crisis to the guided reverie that can fuel astonishing innovation. We start by learning how to move past hubris and anxiety, forms of certainty that hobble our ability to grasp the complexity of high-stakes problems and of life itself. We next explore the mental byways of reverie and forgetting, and learn why cognitive wrong turns, detours, and even errors are not the defeats we take them to be. Even a futile struggle to remember a name or a fact promotes processes of knowledge synthesis and abstraction that are critical to meaning-making. In Part 3, we parse the social side of uncertainty, discovering unsureness as an antidote both for conformity and for hatred of the other. A dissenting opinion in a group, even if wrong, for example, sparks an incertitude that ultimately unearths critical information, typically unshared, in the race to accord. Part 4 takes us to the front lines of humanity's battle for survival, both age-old and in the future. We explore the long-overlooked strengths of people raised in precarity and question the assumption that predictability is what humans, above all, should seek. We end with a startling look at a revolutionary new movement to tame artificial intelligence's dangerous rigidity and unstoppability by making it uncertain. An unpredictable, changeable world has been with us all along. Liberating ourselves from the alluring but mistaken belief that life could be otherwise offers a new vision of human progress and of what it means to know. By the time the world's foremost chemist entered the hunt to find the code of life, his two young rivals had been grappling with the problem for more than a year. But the chemist didn't take the pair seriously. To great fanfare, he had just revealed the structure of the alpha helix, a crucial building block of protein. In 2 years, he would win a Nobel Prize for the discovery. Uncovering the comparatively simple architecture of deoxyribonucleic acid, the suspected keeper of the genetic code, seemed easy for a scientist of his stature. Bold to the point of brashness, the Caltech luminary was convinced he could crack the code. It was just a matter of time. Half a world away in England, his rivals were persevering on a puzzle that they were, by most accounts, unqualified to solve. In world-class science, they were decided unknowns. A restless 24-year-old biologist who'd been rejected for graduate study at Caltech, and a gregarious 36-year-old physicist still working on his PhD. When they joined forces at the University of Cambridge, no one really knew what a gene was. Paradoxically, this key to survival had to be both orderly, to be replicated, and yet irregular, to seed individuality, a kind of snowflake of heredity. Protein, a cell's most active complex molecule, had seemed the right candidate. By parsing wide-ranging work being done with viruses and X-rays, however, the young scientists sensed well before many of their peers that the answer instead lay with a less lively component of life, the DNA found in all living cells. Now, the scientific world had caught up and the end game had begun. Could an astounding breakthrough arise from a pair of researchers whose every step was far from sure? The pressure was on, yet the two worked as before, arguing, experimenting, moving forward, and then back again. They sought out challenging evidence from rivals and colleagues, and continually threw cold water on each other's closely held beliefs. Neither expected a smooth, quick path to success. A brilliant young chemist and her colleague at King's College London made progress by studying DNA's structure on X-rays that later helped corroborate the winning solution. But her focus on a variation of the molecule only found in laboratory settings kept them a step or two behind. "We could not at all see what the answer was," recalled the physicist turned biologist, "but we were determined to think about it long and hard from any relevant point of view." The challenge before them was akin to solving a three-dimensional puzzle that was invisible save for the glimpses caught on ambiguous X-rays. The molecule's proportions and makeup were roughly understood. Long chains of phosphate sugar backbones holding up pairs of nucleotide bases, the letters of the code. But no one really knew whether the chains lay on the inside or the outside of the structure. Did DNA resemble a tight flower stalk with leaf bases or a spiral staircase with nucleotide steps? And what, if anything, would it reveal of the secrets of life? The young scientists were closing in on an answer when they got the news. After less than a week of calculating and drawing, the famous chemist told a colleague he had found the solution. The data didn't quite fit his conclusions, but that did not deter him. His revelation of protein's alpha helix had emerged from a scientific leap of faith. The problem was that this time he ignored any inkling that he might not know. Whereas he had spent years refining his hunch on the alpha helix, he now published in a month, closing his eyes to alternative possibilities and to his colleagues' critiques. "I have practically no doubt," he wrote. "The structure really is a beautiful one." But by viewing the gene as a version of his beloved protein, he ran with a solution that the Cambridge team ruled out a year before, a triple helix in flower stalk form. Worse, he surmised that hydrogen held together the phosphate chains, an impossibility in this chemical milieu. The center could not hold. When the challengers looked in the standard textbook of the day to check their competitor's error, they realized they were reading from the great scientist's own work. Hints of a fiasco were there all along. He had not stopped to look. 1 month after learning of Linus Pauling's breathtaking mistake, James Watson and Francis Crick unveiled a code of pure poetry. It had taken 2 years, complete with false starts, daydreams by the fire, and a formidable capacity to withstand the allure of the easy answer. Their reward was a revelation of surpassing scientific elegance. Unzipped down the middle, the double helix's corkscrewing strands could each create a complementary copy, passing on recipes for proteins that do the work of living. In 1962, Watson, Crick, and King's College scientist Maurice Wilkins shared the Nobel Prize. Rosalind Franklin, whose key contributions were acknowledged by Watson and Crick belatedly and minimally, died before she could be considered for the award. Pauling missed out on one of history's greatest scientific breakthroughs, a defeat that plagued him for the rest of his life. In later years, Crick and others asked Pauling why he had made such a fundamental error. "I don't know," he admitted. For once, he had no ready answer, and in that moment, he revealed the key to his folly and to his rival's brilliance. "Choosing the right problem fueled their success," recalled Crick. "But what mattered was making no assumptions that could not be doubted from time to time." Crick and Watson soared to victory on the wings of the uncertainty that Pauling had shunned. But the story does not end there. After revealing DNA's structure, Crick spent more than a decade leading the quest to unveil its intricate workings. Then he led the way to gaining a foothold into the mysteries of consciousness. Throughout, he remained ever questioning, elevating guesswork to a tactic, prodding colleagues to tap new disciplines, seeing behind the data to their meaning. Watson went on to lead the illustrious Cold Spring Harbor Laboratory and helped launch the first mapping of the human genome. But he retired in shame after asserting that some peoples were genetically less intelligent. Given numerous opportunities to reconsider, he refused to change his view. He lost the courage of a maybe. Most of thought, and life itself, is the pursuit of resolution. Yet along the way, it is uncertainty that equips us to envision the unimaginable, adjust to the unexpected, value a question as deeply as an answer, and find strength in difference and in difficulty. We need not fear the indefinite, for that is where we find the better solution and the path of hope. This is uncertainty's edge. Part 1, Awakenings. Chapter 1, Mind Under Fire, The Shadow Side of Knowing. Whoever cannot seek the unforeseen sees nothing, for the known way is an impasse. Heraclitus. The surgery is going smoothly. The patient lies anesthetized in a Toronto operating room waiting for one of Canada's top surgeons to join the team. A junior surgeon, just 10 weeks into the job, is making the initial incision, exposing a bright red abdominal cavern and a cancerous liver set for partial removal. Slicing into this 3-pound organ, home to 13% of the body's blood supply, is akin to navigating a minefield. Thought by the ancient Greeks to be the seat of emotion, the liver is a nexus of life that is critical to hundreds of vital functions centered mostly on detoxifying the body. For the hand holding the scalpel, it is an organ of perilous surprise. But the senior surgeon, a cancer geneticist and one of the country's leading hepatobiliary specialists, knows the drill. He's been doing this for so many years that his mind sometimes strays mid-operation to the rest of his busy day, although his pace doesn't slacken. He takes pride in his efficiency and expects a routine resection this time. Despite the disease's advance, the sick man's chances are good.
Perched in a nearby waiting area, the senior surgeon munches a bagel and assesses the case with a colleague who will be observing the procedure.
I listen in, preparing to accompany them into the operating room. I've made my way here to witness expert thinking in action and to see what role uncertainty might play in the most urgent of times. Is a surgeon who hesitates in a crisis foolhardy or heroic? Are some heights of excellence best left to the resolutely sure? The surgeon's tale offers critical lessons of promise and folly in an era when the world can upend from one hour to the next. Who will we look to for wisdom in the next freefall? Who are the sages of our day? Popping a last bite of breakfast into his mouth, the senior surgeon lingers before heading off to don mask and gown and get the job done. Most of our business deals with avoiding problems, he says. Most surgery, and I guess most things in life, are like that. Moments later, his scrubbed hands held high, he bursts into the surgery and saunters up to the operating field, sizing up his quarry, a cluster of hard white tumors scarring the liver's right lobe. To excise the cancer, a kind of siege warfare must unfold as the surgeons endeavor to isolate and remove the diseased lobe without harming the healthy left half. The crux of this work will lie in dividing three major blood vessels and a bile duct that variously connect the heart, the liver, and the intestines.
Like rivers that split into two branches, these bodily supply lines each fork just inside the liver by sealing off and then cutting one branch of the hepatic artery, portal vein, bile duct, and hepatic vein. The surgeons can keep the cancer-free half of the liver and the patient alive.
But if they mistakenly cut the main trunk of any of these anatomical structures, the man may quickly bleed to death. The trick is finding what matters amidst layers of tissue, fat, and blood so intricate and anatomically individual that even expert surgeons sometimes lose their bearings. Articles in the field warn practitioners of myriad anatomical variations that no medical textbook fully depicts. We don't like to say, "What the hell is that?" too often, jokes the senior surgeon, but we do say it occasionally. It's always a bad sign. Surgeons must be very careful, wrote Emily Dickinson, when they take the knife. Underneath their fine incisions stirs the culprit, life. Like saboteurs on a moonless night, the surgeon and his student creep forward, excavating the liver and surrounding tissue with a cautery as the sour scent and smoke of burning flesh pervade the room. The young doctor, new and cautious, works slowly. The senior surgeon guides her, tells war stories, orders the nurses about, and grows impatient. Halfway through an operation, he usually begins watching the clock, a habit now typical in a field besieged by lean profits, overworked staff, and increasingly complex diseases. All the pressures in healthcare are on the side of production, notes safety expert Peter Pronovost. At this hospital, any operation running overtime is tagged with a red flag. Such tallies of efficiency can influence a surgeon's future allotment of cases. For a profession schooled to be relentlessly bold, the aim is clear. Speed is the gold standard and doubt an unwelcome intrusion. And medicine, to deal with uncertainty, is to make it go away, says one physician scientist. Then we're done. So this is the right artery, the senior surgeon announces. It's big, actually, he adds, suddenly taken back. At this juncture, the pair is working at the organ's lower end to uncover a trio of close-packed vessels, including the hepatic artery that ferries oxygenated blood from the heart into the liver. Spotting a hefty bit of artery here might show that they found their target, the vessel's expendable right branch, albeit in extra-large size. The patient is a tall man. Or instead, the structure's generous size could indicate they are in dangerous territory and may be about to sever the artery's main stem. The senior surgeon, mind made up, orders the trainee to seal off and cut the structure in hand. But she insists on first temporarily closing off the section of artery in question with a clamp and then feeling for a pulse in the vessel's nearby left branch to check its viability, a caution he calls paranoid, then begrudgingly permits. Confirming his call, she makes the cut. Yet the encounter is telling, the observing doctor later explains. A renowned scientist and surgeon in her own right, Carol Ann Moulton is my guide to the critical judgments unfolding before me. Formerly the senior surgeon's student, and now his relentlessly questioning peer, she has spent more than a decade probing quandaries like these, when, amidst high-stakes predicaments, much is not as it seems. A global authority on surgical expertise, whose influence extends far beyond medicine, Moulton is at the forefront of one of cognitive science's most challenging endeavors, decoding how we can wrestle a solution from the clutches of a fast-evolving problem, how we can grapple with spiraling unknowns. That day, with a clock ticking and a life at risk, we would see the expert mind on the fly, all dexterity and decision, and witness its precarious limits. He didn't want to spend 2 or 3 minutes clamping the artery, Moulton tells me later. He was happy to take that chance and divide it for the sake of efficiency and time. Speed matters, for the longer the operation, the higher the risk of complications, especially in complex procedures. There are times when you need to keep moving, says Moulton. Yet hasty assurance under fire, she argues, is the dangerous siren call of our day. Calm and athletic, with a strong jaw, an easy smile, and a penchant for questioning the status quo, Moulton is gaining accolades for challenging our outdated assumptions about the nature of superior performance.
Her quest is helping to reveal a dramatic new understanding of how true expertise is achieved and why, more than ever, we need such prowess.
Cut along the line, orders the older surgeon, pointing to the increasingly visible boundary between a healthy russet left lobe and the now darkening right liver. Go back and forth. Good, he says. He's approaching the most critical point in the endeavor, the division of the crucial duct carrying digestive fluid called bile into the intestines. Would he honor the situation's complexities, recognize that danger is near? Not for the first time during the operation, Moulton interjects to urge caution. But the surgeon plows on. Faster, faster, he says. The diseased lobe is nearly free. And that's when Moulton's warnings come home. Quick, automatic, and assured. Know-how is synonymous with fluency, built up over time. Veteran physicians diagnose from across the room, all the more so in emergencies. Fire chiefs make 80% of their tactical decisions in less than a minute. A magical ease seems the epitome of professional excellence, whether we are chairing a meeting or leading a battle. Experts long have been the people we trust to jump to a conclusion. Novices awkwardly lag behind. What are the roots of this facility? What makes the pros so quick and so sure? To begin to investigate the expert mind under fire, let us step back in time to August 1939, when a Belgian freighter set off for a weeks-long voyage to Argentina under the shadow of imminent war. En route to the World Chess Olympiad were most of Europe's champions, as well as a Dutch team member determined to use the royal game as a new laboratory for the study of judgment. This was a time when many in the psychology field, under the sway of behavioralism, deemed the mind's workings nearly impossible to decode. But a wave of inventive European researchers would help prove them wrong.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.